success, champagne, good French champagne and so on. Google designer of the success, we had 250 journalists that day. Google dedicated us the logo. That day the logo was this one. We kept it, of course. It's very rare that Google changes its logo for an event and so on. Very rare. And in his wife, as you know, was more wide than us, Google, because here they put a spark, like an explosion. And really something happened. 9 days after only, to see how reality you can pass very easily from the altar to the dust, really. That's his life. Only 9 days after. 19 September 2008, the big trouble. You see, these are two magnets. These are the two values of the magnet. The magnet, they are a current flows in the magnet, this super current that generates this magnetic field in the superconductor. But the current needs to be passed from one magnet to the other, so we need to do a junction. The junction is not a complicated thing. Actually, it's resistive, it's not a very high tech part. That's why maybe we mislook this one. So, this is the junction. You see better in this expansion. You see better in this expansion. And this is the superconducting cable that brings the 15,000 amps. Think how much the current that you have in your house. This is 15,000 amps. This small cable, half an inch wide, one tenth of an inch thick. Very small one. And this is the junction where it's done. It's done. And one junction burned out, and we had a really big disaster. Really. You imagine? We had an electrical arc with burning. This is completely disrupted. We don't have nothing to hide. We did a big mistake, we had a big damage. This is electrical arc, helium spill off. And helium spill, you know, helium is very cold. What does it mean? That for helium, room temperature is like for water, if you bring water on the sun. There is the same ratio of energy between helium temperature and room temperature, between room temperature and sun. So what does a bowl of water, if you bring on the sun, immediately evaporates? And helium, touching room temperature, immediately evaporates. It creates a big wave of pressure. We did a mistake also in the pressure release system, unfortunately, that was not able to cope for such event. We designed it for some speed of helium, but not for such a big speed of helium. So basically, the wave of pressure took magnet 30 metric tons heavy. I repeat, it's like, you know, this big truck that we see only in the American movie, but you see every day, you know, this big truck full of char, really push one each other like straw, basically. You see what is the extension of the damage here. So basically, we had 700 meters of our accelerator completely destroyed to be replaced. We in the unluckiness, we were lucky because we had just barely the number of reserve magnets just barely to substitute the one damage. Because we were got in the middle, we had already closed of our industry production, we didn't set up yet the magnet hospital, as we call it, the magnet clinic that we have now inserted to repair all the magnet. So we were really in the no man's land. Very dangerous situation. Fortunately, we had just barely the spare. We work, it was very interesting because in CERN, of course, many people said it was a single mistake, we need to find the guy. He said, no, he said, we don't need to find the guy, we have to blame ourselves. Not to try to find always the guilty. I take the responsible of the magnet system. I take the responsible. They want the people that did the mistake go to repair. Because these are the experienced people. We should not blame the people. We should blame us, the physicists, the engineers, that we are responsible, that we didn't, eventually we didn't produce enough procedure to avoid this. We should not give the fault to the guy that has done the job. And in fact, by doing this, we realized that our accelerator has a diffuse weakness. And that's why, even if after repair, we push our accelerator only half its power, 60% of its power. And now we are doing a fixing, a consolidation, to fully cancel this diffuse weakness that there is in the accelerator. And really, it was very difficult to understand this, because people were find like completely without energy, exhausted by this, but by saying, don't worry guys, it's my fault, it's my fault. It has been the most rewarding thing that I've done in my career, taking the fall. Because by doing this, people were immediately liberated, freed by the mechanism. Its own fault, trying to get out. And because of this, all the energy was not in trying to give the fall to another, but in trying to make a repair. It's something I learned, I tell you, for my children. This is the making. When my children have something wrong, I really look them with much pretension way. Because I realize that the point is not to make mistakes. The point is to understand you are there, how you get out of this. To be positive. And that is the point. It's not pretending that, not the moralist, the pretension that things doesn't happen. But it's the fact that we have the energy and the resource to get out of this. And this is the way. I tell you very frankly, I started to look, because for me was a setback. You can imagine, for a few days, I didn't sleep. I revived in my mind. I imagined what's happening here in this point. Many times, I can say that I can have a picture in my head what's happened there, the spark and so on, and distraction. And really, I found, first of all, for myself, also the courage to say, I've done a mistake. It's usually something we never say. But I tell you that the moment one admits this, it has all the energy to go through. It's the moralist that kills us, because the moralist usually is something that impedes to admit we've done a mistake. And the moralist, in fact, is somebody perfect, that thinks to be perfect and pretend perfection from the other. And by doing this, really, you not only believe, but in less than 1 year, we have been able to recover. It took them a few times to start the accelerator. And this is the third passage of the beam in the accelerator after the incident. It's wonderful, because this is 27 kilometers, and in the Y, there is the oscillation of the beam. At the first through, the beam passes through the 27 kilometers, oscillating only less than 2 millimeters. Nothing. Now it's better. It's oscillating only half a millimeter. But already the first through, that really were a relief from this. And in fact, immediately, almost immediately after, 2 weeks after, we were able to take out the record from the of energy from the American Tevatron, the big accelerator that is we consider the father of the LHC, that for 30 years was the biggest accelerator in the world, the Tevatron in Chicago, in the Fermi Lab. So we have been able to take out the record, so we make a picture of the beam. Literally, this is the particle beam before we throw it away. By the way, you see that the beam is not something continuous, the beam is bunched, is by bunch. Packet, you can call it, and each packet, each bunch, is kind of a teeny cylinder, 20, 30 centimeter long, at 10 inches, but very thin, 1 millimeter thick only, and in this very teeny, a little bit more than a hair, and this very thin little hair, you believe, there are, in this one, there are 100 billion protons. It still is completely vacuum. It's very difficult to get collision. We need to squeeze the beam as much as possible the collision in order to implement the number of collisions. These are the first events. You see, now it's not anymore a computer simulation like I showed before. This is a real event. So it's what we see. You can say, what we see? Do you really believe that we see this? We don't see this. What we see is something very indirect. We see electric signal on our detector, that then we reconstruct. Thanks to our model, to our intelligence, to reconstruct it, we say, this was an electron, this was a proton, whatever it is, a pion, so, or the tip of particle. We never see directly this thing. In this act of seeing, there is always the part that depends on the subject, which is our collective intelligence, the model, the analysis of the model. And then we started to have, after 1 year, the first hint of the X. This was a signal. You see these four red traces, that it was really look like this, but as I told you, since it is very indirect, you can have also events which are not X events that fake, that generate a signal similar to the one of the decay of the X. So we need to be sure, in other words. It's like to see, but not to. How to say sfocato? Sorry for. Blurry. It's like to see blurry. And you need to better focus your eyes in order to see better. And to see better means to create more events and to create more statistics. And in fact, in December 2001, we have been able, I don't know if you see this, may I ask to turn off the light, please? Because there is some, otherwise, a beautiful image, if possible, eh? If possible, otherwise. And you see, if this is, okay, thanks. You see these four straight red traces, exactly like the one that I show you, they were in yellow. These are four moons. You see X decays in two particles Z, that you don't see neither the X neither the particle Z. We see the final product, the grandchildren, the four moons. You see, it's already difficult to identify the moons in this haystack, really, to identify the needle, which we can say, the moon. And then plus, we need to do this reconstruction about two generations.
And you know, we were sure 99.5%. But since the knowledge is so indirect, we couldn't say 99.5% is a good fairly certainty in normal life. You would bet your money in the lotto or in a bingo if you are sure to win at 99.5%. I'm sure you will bet almost your money. Even if Dr. Jacobson will bet the money of the center, probably, it's a very good probability to win. But for us, it's not enough, absolutely. We know that we can be tricked by the actual, let's put it this way. So we need to verify more. Our mission was keep verifying. And finally, in a very crowded Auxerre auditorium, you see Professor Riggs make us the pleasure to come and to be there at the announcement. Of course, we told him, but Professor Riggs is a very modest, very shy person, very vulgar person, is very humble, and usually doesn't speak very much, and we were very afraid he would not have come, because he didn't like to be in public. In fact, he cried at the announcement, really. He cried, and he said a very nice phrase. He said, "I would never have believed to see this in my lifetime." In fact, we were in a hurry. When he had the accident, we were very worried, because Professor Riggs was seriously ill at the time, was not in a good shape, and you know, Nobel Prize cannot give to persons which are deceased, which are passed away. So you need to give on, can be only given, this is the rule, only to living people. So we really wanted to have Professor Riggs the Nobel Prize, and we really hope that this year he will get it. So in a very crowded auditorium, we could make the announcement, and this is one of the most significant figures. You see two electrons, which is another signature of the Higgs, passing away in a way that can be reasonably explained only as if an Higgs particle has been generated here, and through two or three generations of decay, it generated finally this one. This is a picture from CMS. I know there are used to people working on CMS. So, but you see, the evidence is like in normal life, it's a very teeny thing. You see, this is the curve that we would have without Higgs particle. It's what we call the noise. Also for this auditorium, this is the curve of the noise. And this is the signature of this particle. It's a very teeny evidence. In fact, to me, you know, in a school, at the end of the lesson, in a school where children go after the bell ring, lesson finished, everybody's crying and so on, and trying to understand a melodia. Trying to understand it is very difficult. You have to have, so getting this part, you need to be accustomed. You need to do a lot of measurement, a lot of analysis. Really, the path to the truth is really indirect. That is the point of what we want to say. And in fact, you see, this is the evolution of the certainty. Certainty is not something that we have immediately. It's not immediate evidence. To cut it short, this is the line without this particle, and this is the first in sign of this particle, and this is the local probability. That means if you are 10 to minus 1, you are 99% of probability, 10 to minus 2, excuse me, 10 to minus 2, means that you have 99% probability that it is true and 1% that is not true. So you are still out 1 out of 100. 10 to minus 3 means to be sure in one part out of 1,000. That means 99.9% probability that is true and 0.1% that is not true, and so on and so on. So we were here, we were not even at 1%. This was not good enough. Then when I showed the picture before, the one with the four red traces, we were here, we announced hints. We cannot say discovery, hints of the Higgs. Then, you know, the certainty went back a little bit. The certainty went back because it's a statistical situation. We have this kind of thing, so we were a little bit trembling. And then finally, 4th of July, we passed the 1 part 10 to minus 6. That means we were sure to better than 1 part in a million. Better than 1 part in a million. So we had 999,999% part that was true, and only 1 part of a billion possibility to be not true. Is a very small, and at this point we can claim, this is the method of particle physics, we can claim that a sure observation has been done. But you see, we arrive to the certainty step by step. Little by little, certainly not something that comes immediately. But this is the beginning. What is the next? You know,
This is a complicated graph, but to try to make it simple, I can explain it this way. Higgs can decay, can transform, let's say, in a different particle. For example, it can become two photons, light. It can become two Z particles,
and eventually become four moons, as I show you,
and so on. So the bottom line that if the Higgs is exactly the Higgs foreseen by Professor Higgs, all this black spot sustain in the green bar. You see why, for example, Higgs in gamma-gamma, that means that it becomes light, is outside the green bar. And plus, its error from which is outside, which is the red bar horizontal, is smaller than the distance. That means it's not compatible. That means there are signs, maybe, that the Higgs boson is the Higgs boson, but it's not exactly as foreseen. And is what this is what we would like, that is the Higgs boson, but it's some unexpected property. So there is something to see. We need to measure that property. It's like the, if the police got a guy, finally, that was wanted, and now you have to question, you have to know the guys, where he was born, and so on, and so on. We need to know the properties. For example, we don't know a basic property of this Higgs boson, which is called speed, which is an intrinsic problem. You know, all particles is strange, but all particles kind of rotate on the shell. We don't know if they rotate, but they behave like if they rotate. Then we say, we call this intrinsic spin, intrinsic angular momentum, intrinsic spin. And we need to know what is an intrinsic spin of, the, of this particle. It's a very important property. And then finally, what can be in front of us, you know, the most accredited theory says that the Higgs boson cannot stay alone. It's not natural, let's say it this way, that the Higgs boson exists alone. To stabilize the Higgs boson itself is not stable. To stabilize the Higgs boson, you need other type of particle. You remember when I mentioned this theory? Supersymmetry. What is supersymmetry? It's a theory that claims that to each particle, you need the lighter one, they, each particle, they have a pattern which is much heavier, which is kind of a symmetry. Above, below this mirror, you can see this plane like a mirror. And below this mirror, there is another world of heavier particle, heavier companion of the particle. If this is true, you understand that this it is probably the famous dark matter. Something that when we started to build LHC, we did not imagine that existed. Now maybe we can get the LHC when we start back in 2015. Now, as I said, this is shut down. We need to make some repair in the LHC, some maintenance, and then we start again. If this theory is true, certainly we will get in 2015. So not only the Higgs boson, maybe there is a super world ahead of us, waiting for us. Waiting for us. And that's why I'm leading this project, which is called high luminosity. We want to realize a collision like this. Well, why high luminosity? Because, you know, now we have open our accelerator. We have turned it on. We have seen what there is. It's like to see with this light. And you see something. But you cannot identify, you want to know better what it is, this something. You ask the person, say, please, can you turn on more light? You want to have more light to see better. That's why we call high luminosity. We will generate much more many collisions. We will generate much more light to see better what we have discovered. And this is the high luminosity project, but what we call HLLAC, high luminosity. And you see, in terms of technology, what is the step? This is what is the evolution of the magnetic field. You see in the vertical axis the value of magnetic field versus years. We started in 75 to produce a velocity magnet. We arrived to the LHC around 2010 to produce field of the order of 8 Tesla, as you call it technically. And we know that with the LHC technology, we cannot go beyond this red line, between 8 and 9 Tesla. For high luminosity, we need to do a step through. We need to go to produce magnet around 12, 13 Tesla. It's very strong field, eh? And this is called high luminosity LHC. And this is the step that we want to reach in 10 years from now. And for this, we need to invent this technology. Not invent, but to perfectionate this technology. And but what you have in mind, and what can be the step after? Because in our technology, you see, the time scale is 20 years, 20, 25 years. It's like the people that were building the cathedral. In fact, the accelerator, you can say, are the modern cathedral. To build a cathedral, I come from Milano, we say that it's never ended. In Milano, we say, when a work is never ended, say, it's like the Duomo of Milano. It's never ending. And okay, but actually, it was ending in 100 years, more or less. Third generation, people working for the future. But the, who is father and mother? No, nothing is more rewarding than to work for our children. So I work for my PhD student. I work for the student. And I had the pleasure to get from my professor that started to conceive the LSE. I was very young guy at that time. I didn't participate in the conception of the LSE. I profited from that. And now I need to make you profiting. And so we are thinking, after the high luminosity, 10 years from now, what we can do after? You need to go further. Because to turn on an accelerator is like to enter in a room. You see something, and then you want to have more light, high luminosity. But when you have seen everything, you have measured everything, usually what's happened is that you see other door. And the other door is like opening a new accelerator that opens on a new wall. I like very much, you know, this movie, Narnia, I don't know who has seen this, especially the first one. It's not beautiful, the image that you open the magic armoire, the magic armoire, okay, the cabinet, whatever it is, I don't know, wardrobe, the magic wardrobe, and there is a full world ahead of us to be discovered. And it's very nice because in Narnia they say,